a microphone. So thank you for coming back, and we will be talking more about Hovanda's molecular simulations. I pointed out already that we are using gigantic computers nowadays, like the Blue Waters computer with 300,000 cores that permit us to do simulations of over 200 million atoms. And even in the lab, you can get yourself for reasonable price tag of a few $10,000 clusters of computers, GPU accelerated, that can also do easily a few hundred thousand atoms. So most of you will be absolutely fine with the size of your system. But a serious problem is how long the simulations go in terms of not wall clock time, but in terms of real physical time covered. And I indicated already when I pointed out that we have to discretize the Newton equation of motion in time, that we have to choose a time step of about a femtosecond, while many processes of interest are of a millisecond. And that is would require then to do 10 to the 12 integration steps. Each integration step takes on the computer today around a millisecond. You cannot really do it much faster. And if you now do the arithmetic, then you find that a millisecond will take you like clearly several years, even on the latest computers. And these computers don't get faster. You can throw more computer power at the simulation, but these computers come to a screeching halt while you do that. When you are putting too few processors on too few atoms on one processor. So let's say you have a 100,000 atom simulation and you are taking 100,000 cores, then it will not be very fast because every core will be done with the computation needed for its atom very, very quickly, and then the cores have to talk to each other. And the communication backbone of the computer that we have today is too slow for that. So so if you would do that, then literally the simulation would be very, very slow. The best is that you give each processor about, now I talk about processors, not cores, about 1,000 atoms. Then they are busy, you know, 1,000 atoms. To calculate all the forces from them requires some work. And so then while one processor is busy, some other processor can communicate with a third processor. And that works out much better. So if you have this kind of load balance between computing and communication, that the processor is busy with about 1,000 atoms, then the slow communication of modern computers can do it. There is one special individual, namely David Shaw, who is actually from his days back a professor of computer science at Columbia University. He started then a very successful hedge fund, and so today is also one of the richest Americans. And he has our field of molecular modeling as his hobby, and he threw several hundred million dollars at the problem and his ideas, and he built a computer that is completely special purpose, can only do molecular dynamics, and also even only sort of like I don't want to call it really boring, but you know what I mean, boring variety, not something, not a very special calculation. And that way he could make the computer communicate much faster by basically having his whole computer being sort of one big chip where every processor can get into the memory of every other processor, at least the neighboring ones. And so he built this very special computer. It was a great, it was very audacious, and praise on him that he was so audacious, and he succeeded. But it's not a general purpose computer that NSF could buy, because they couldn't just have a computer for our community. Okay, so we have a time problem, and that permits us presently to do simulations relatively easily of 100 nanoseconds. So if anybody is your graduate student or yourself, you think you want to only do a shorter simulation, you should, you know, if you have good reason, it's fine. You don't need to simulate longer than necessary. But you should also not complain, say, oh, 100 nanoseconds is so long. The competition is doing 100 nanoseconds. If there's a reason for you to 100 nanoseconds, do 100 nanoseconds. And now, in better to do groups or groups with more patient students and tougher bosses, they do simulations between a microsecond and 10 microseconds. And if you have students that have who have a very high pain threshold, they can do simulations of several 10 microseconds. So we did on normal computers simulation up to 70 microseconds. Now here in Pittsburgh is an Anton computer donated by Shaw, and that there you can get computer time, but you're limited to do 40 microseconds a year. But that might be also a solution for you. And so I think they have once yearly a competition where you can enter. I think the competition this year was just recently, so you probably would have to wait a little. You can ask Markus Dietrich. He was for many years organizing it. He might still do it, but he definitely should know about it. So he can tell you about the detail. Okay, and so the reason I mentioned already yesterday is that we have all these interleaf processes. The fastest motion that we need to reproduce are hydrogen and carbon and nitrogen vibrations. They are between 10 femtosecond and 100 femtoseconds. They need to be resolved, so we have to go to 1 femtosecond step. And then we have, you know, this kind of hinge bending and vibrations of the protein, of a certain domain of the protein, and then folding of small proteins or larger conformation transitions in the protein, allosteric transition. They're all sort of processes that are interwoven, so you cannot just basically say this process is sort of like the result of a statistical process, but rather there are too many continuous processes going on that you have to just do 1 femtosecond at a time to reach it. Okay, so this is our main problem, and you have to be aware of it. So don't forget it. Your project needs to be done in a microsecond, roughly. If it cannot be done in a microsecond, then you don't do it. Yes, I give you, I right after my lecture, I make a PDF file and I give you a PDF file. So now, however, we are doing many projects that govern processes that are much slower than a microsecond. We have done it since many years and we will continue it. But there we cannot go straight forward. We cannot say computer, run and describe the process from the short time on, all the way the process takes. How do we do this? We set up the computer in certain situations that we think are important mechanistically to reach the long step. For example, we say, this is a reaction path, and we try just to find the reaction path, not the full dynamic length. And then we say, here are the barriers, and we study the barriers, and so then piece by piece, we put together the process that is that happens over a millisecond or maybe even slower, but we have to be very intelligent, very careful, and only being that way, plus having been intelligent in setting up the reaction paths and studying then the intermediates, can we do this? So we have to really basically formulate a hypothesis on the physical mechanism that gets you from A to B when A and B are connected by a process that takes more than a microsecond. So I find it wonderful that one has to be intelligent and is just pushing the button on the computer. And not a lot of good science was done that way, and so it's not a problem. Now, sometimes you can be guided by experiment. Experiment can tell you certain places along the path. You have done experiments on, here's a slow process, intermediate that has been characterized. You might also get help from experiment through nuclear magnetic resonance, through electron microscopy that might capture intermediates. And so this is of course the best situation, that you try to see if there is an opportunity for experimental input to guide this. There are also fantastic programs written that find reaction paths that automate it, but automating means not you don't have to think anymore. Automating means they amplify your thinking, they help you. You don't have to do every little piece, but maybe certain steps you can then have an algorithm, they're called transition path sampling algorithms, fill in the intermediate connection, and so there is a lot of help, but really it is up to you, the investigator, to formulate a hypothesis or a series of hypotheses that characterize the process. And so if we are in a field where we have big computers, that doesn't mean that we should stop thinking. And now I don't raise my voice because of the microphone, otherwise I would have now start screaming to tell you one truth. And that is the dumbest thing you can do, the absolute dumbest thing you can do is actually use a computer. What I mean by that? If you put the computer there and say, oh, computer, just go on. I don't have a clue what's going on, but you simulate for me and I will find it out. It can happen one time. You all sometimes, this old lady won in the lottery, $530 million or whatever, I didn't win it, she wins it, good for her. But this is total lottery. The computer is the last instrument you want to use for searching. We use it for searching. We do conformational sampling with it. And you have to learn those methods. But in general, if you don't have a clue, and then you push the button and run a simulation, hope that you are learning something, you will be bitterly disappointed, I would say, 99% of the time. And so don't do that. Think beforehand. Formulate hypotheses. Formulate expectations. And set up the simulation such that they might give you an answer regarding your hypothesis. If you look at good experiments, it's the same story. The greatest experiments were beautifully formulated questions to nature done in the form of an experiment. And so as computational biologists, we should also do the same. We should formulate questions and then answer them in beautifully set up computational experiment. So one should think of the computer much more as a computational experimental laboratory than just as sort of like something that is doing all the sampling for me, that automated, I go on vacation and the computer is doing the work when I come back. The world, the mysteries of the world are all in front of me and I can write my Nature paper. Okay, so please remember the computer is the dumbest thing you can use for getting ideas. You have to get ideas yourself. And you can use a computer very well to test ideas. So basically, most of what we do is hypothesis testing in the field of computational biology and molecular mechanics. So So now I want to quickly go more into sort of like the details, the routine things. And one of the things we need to know when we don't want to do a simulation is we need a structure, just a static structure of the atoms to start from. And those are given to us most of the time in the form of PDB files. And the PDB file, they contain, you know, the atoms, what type of atoms there they are, if it's a protein, in what kind of residue they are. They number the residues, they give them the X, Y, Z coordinate of the atoms. Sometimes they also tell you how likely this particular position is occupied. An experiment may show actually that it's only occupied half of the time. We don't know where the other half is, so they say half of the time is here, half of the time is there. So it's, you have an occupancy. The temperature factor I will be talking about later, it tells you the degree of vibrational local disorder. And then also if your protein is made of several segments, then it might give you a segment ID. It doesn't give you hydrogen atoms. We must add them ourselves. And you may think, oh, this is bad. My God, half of the atoms are not there. But the hydrogen atoms, to add the hydrogen atom takes the intelligence, which is not a low intelligence, beginning chemistry student. You know, that's very easy to place them. And then when they're placed, they move anyway. So they're not standing exactly at one position. And so given that they move, and given that it's very clear to assign them, it is not a problem. And there's many programs in VMD. We have a program in that places hydrogen atoms very routinely, so not a problem. I actually personally don't like to look at any structure without the hydrogen atoms, so when I get it from the PDB, I first add the hydrogen atoms so that it looks to me more normal, chemically speaking, than if I don't see the hydrogen atoms. Okay, so then with the coordinates, you can fill in the coordinates that arise in the potential that you use in the molecular mechanics simulations. Here, all these angles and stuff you can calculate from both coordinates of the atoms. But what you also need to know is the parameters that characterize the various degrees of freedom. And they depend on the chemistry, chemical topology of the system. Basically, what kind of chemical bonds do we have? And the chemical bond, if it's a C-C bond, there are many, many, many different types of C-C bonds, carbon-carbon bonds in organic materials. Ask a student, they would tell you, if you're a physicist, oh, it's a C-C bond, it's a C-C bond, no matter where. They would laugh you, like you like crazy hysterically. So the C-C bond depends on what is the next bond, and so on and so on. So you need to know this, and that is described by a file that is called, oops, where is it? Sorry, I thought I just had edited. Okay, I don't see it. I hope I don't have other problems. So this is done by a file that is called the PSF file, the protein structure file. And the protein structure file basically characterizes the chemical nature of your macromolecule. And so it's like a good chemist that looks at it, oh, this is this type of C-C bond, this is this kind of CO bond, this is this kind of NH bond, and this is this kind of CH bond, and so on. They give it. And you need to have lots of chemical knowledge to assign this properly, and this is being written down in a language that this force field can understand. So basically, there's a program then in NMD that translates now the PSF file into what parameters to choose here, because the parameters are being developed for the particular chemical bonds and chemical plural bonds in the neighborhood, adjacent bonds that make up a macromolecule. Now, this sounds already all a little fuzzy, and when I say you need some experience from chemistry, it sounds also a little dangerous, and it is. It for a very long time, our field suffered from something that I knew well as a little child. There was a storybook about, I don't know what the English word for it. It's a German here, Schlaraffenland. Anybody can translate that? It's a land of milk and honey, where kids want to be, like the streets are made of candy, and candy hangs in the streets, and when you open your mouth, the fried chicken fly into the mouth, and it's just really wonderful, all you wanted to do. But to get there, you had to eat yourself through a huge wall of what is called in German Grießbrei, grit pudding or something, the least liked food source for children. So you had to first go through this awful food before you could go to the land of milk and honey. So it was really like this, you know, first you have to do something awful and then you have all the fun. And this is how this field was. You had to first do your PSF file, often for a compound that, for example, in pharmacology, you have a new compound, you have to now put all the chemistry in there to specify the chemistry, and then you have to even quantum chemically determine this. But luckily, there have been many hard-working people, and there are some excellent teachers of it, and one of the excellent teachers is actually Imad Takosh, and he can make this look like fun. And we of course also have some very nice tools in NEMD and VMD that help you. And also Imad Takosh is a great collaborator who has been written recently a program that can really do this much more automated and much more easily than ever before. So this, you can fly with a helicopter now over that wall as a child and land right away into the land of milk and honey, which is the land of doing volcanic simulations. Okay, so now once you are there, then let's say we want to prepare a system and we want to study this membrane protein, which is a BC1 complex. And so this is a membrane part. When you would make a surface representation of the protein and color by amino acid type, you would see all white here, because this is a hydrophobic region that is then fitted into the lipid membrane, this piece. And so now we have to put this protein into its environment. So we take the PDB file of the protein, and now we are building the environment. Lipid membrane here, and water here, and water here. If it's a water-soluble protein, it's more easy, so we can just put water everywhere. But if it's a membrane protein, we better do membrane there. So this will also be a little bit a subject of Imad Takosh, who has developed wonderful methods to solvate these proteins into the membrane. So here we have a membrane with lipids, and green stuff are lipids, tails, and the head groups. Then we add the water, so sometimes more easily said than done. For example, the density of the material is not so clear. You know, we know the density of bulk water of lipid far away from the protein, but near the protein we don't. And so then you are doing constant pressure simulations to let the system choose its own density. So when you have achieved this, then you can begin with your molecular dynamic simulations. So now, however, when you do this, there comes two big problems. And the first one is that the protein that we deal in the computer are men's proteins, our proteins. They're described by the force field of scientists, not of nature. The protein structures that we get from experiment are nature's proteins. They are governed by the forces of nature. Of course, we try to bring the two close together, but we can do only so much. And the difference shows up brutally right at the beginning in a very, you could say, almost unimportant way, because we can get around it. But if you don't know it, then it will be explosively bad. So you have many little errors there in this protein that you translate now from nature into the computational force field, and they add up. Usually they add up to the negative. So you're getting collisions, spherical repulsion, and so on. And so if you would now start a simulation, you are in that energy landscape that makes up how the energy of a protein depends on moving all the parts around. You are high in the mountain, you are on a cliff, you are hanging there somewhere. Just to, not from real deep problems, but rather just to the fact that there are these little errors that accumulate. And if you would now start simulating, you would go faster than the speed of light in this direction, and it's not really faster than the speed of light, although it's possible. We do classical mechanics and we can break the speed of light barrier, but the force is so strong that your time step of 1 femtosecond would be way too long. You would be already going several angstroms away, and the simulation would be totally unstable. So you have to do something else. You have to guide the system down into the valley from the high mountain. And the way you do that is very simply. You do that through energy minimization. You want to find a minimum. And so the way you do this is that you energy minimize your system. And that is basically you're moving at temperature zero. So constantly you are quenching the velocities to zero, so that the system just drifts down the energy. And that can be done very easily, numerically. There are many algorithms for it, no problem. But then you add up in this little minimum there. It's like somebody who climbed the mountain slides down here and then with the fingers hangs there in the cliff. And this is not a real minimum. This is still high up in the mountain. And so now you must find the valley. And so now you must overcome this barrier. And you can do that again. At this moment, you would have to start the molecular dynamics simulation and heat it a little bit so that you're getting over the barrier. And then you might cool it again, the energy minimize, or go to very low temperature. Heat, cool, heat, cool, heat, cool, so that you are hopefully ending up in the valley. Of course, you never can tell. The protein is not saying, oh, no, I'm in the valley. So you have to sort of, it's a little bit up to your the judgment. But, you know, you can also read what other people have been doing, and they got then good results with certain what you call minimization, and then heating cooling cycles. You call that actually annealing, because it comes from metallurgy, where you anneal metals by heating and cooling, then make you particularly strong. And so you're doing this annealing cycle, you find out what they do, and you do something similar. Sometimes you, for example, start to only do molecular dynamics on one part of the system, maybe only on the water, and then only on the lipids and the water, and then protein still frozen, and then you begin to also simulate the water. So you might also, at one point, separate this process into the different components being done differently. That you see best in reading the literature. Now you're here, and so now we're in the valley. Good, great, no. This is how a protein really looks like conceptually. It has an energy landscape of many minima. And it might well be that the enzyme you study is active in this minimum, but you land it in this minimum. And it could well be even that the barrier is so high that it might take a millisecond to get over it. And nobody can help you there. Actually, not really true, but that is the way. So if you would start here, you would study a protein that just happens to be in a boring state. Now you can sample these conformations through several algorithms, and one of the most popular one is called replica exchange algorithm, where you basically have one protein or several proteins simulated. You know, you simulate an ensemble of proteins, and let's say 100 are simulated at your physiological temperature, and then 100 are simulated at 400 Kelvin temperature, 500 Kelvin temperature, and so on. And now in this ensemble, there are rules that the proteins can change ensemble. They can jump from a low to higher or from higher lower. I don't want to tell you what the rules are. They are there, and the rules are done so well that when you follow the rules, you are getting a Boltzmann distributed conformational distribution on the bottom layer with your 300 Kelvin. So you jump between, and now you can say that you can sense that if you're going jumping in between the 400K or 500K, then you have a chance to get over the barrier, but then you jump back down and you behave thermodynamically totally correctly. You don't overpopulate anything. If you look at your Boltzmann distribution for the potential you have, it's just the famous Boltzmann distribution, e to the minus potential over KBT. So you need conformational sampling. You have to be warned. This is just the way proteins behave. And it's still a subject of intense investigation that people realize more and more that proteins have many conformational substates. And some of them are just so close in geometry that you don't want to talk much about it. But sometimes they even have quite considerable difference in conformation. And so people study that quite intensely today. And this is just the way nature made proteins, and you have to deal with it. So I told you about the dilemma of slow simulations, and there are some ways of overcoming the dilemma by cutting corners, and one is shown here. It's called coarse graining. Here we have a lipoprotein, two lipoproteins, lipoprotein particles actually called, two lipoproteins, one in blue, one in green, surrounding lipids. And here you see a full atom representation of this system. It's embedded in water. And here you see now a simplification of the system where you represent the full detail by beads that are, for example, representing about 10 atoms typically. And now you're getting a simpler simulation. Or you say, oh yes, of course you get a simpler simulation because it is, I have fewer atoms. No, there's more to it than that. What's more to it is that not only do you get your atom count down, but the interactions in this system are the average interactions between 10 atoms here, in this one here, 10 atoms here and 10 atoms there. So you are moving in, one second, you're moving in a potential that is average over the motions of 10 atoms here and 10 atoms there, and then you see how these groups move, and that potential is much smoother than the full atomic model, the full atomic potential. It has less barriers, and so things move much faster here and relax much faster than they do on this side. So in addition to the atom count that is lower, you're getting a smoother potential.
So when we put this in NAMDI, do we still have to have a thousand sort of coarse grain bits per core? Or since they represent 10 atoms, can we have
No, you can have thousand. Because the force field calculation for a bead is about the same as for an atom.
So we have fewer than 1,000 coarse grain bits per core.
You can experiment, it might be a little bit more complicated, but in general the answer is it's about as much work for the processor to compute the forces for the coarse grain than it is for the atom. The reason is that the averaging is not done on the fly. The averaging was done beforehand by people who designed now potentials for these coarse grain systems, and you don't see. They averaged and now give you new formulas for the potentials between beats that very much look like the formula that you have for the atoms, except now the parameters are different and the masses are different and so on. Okay. So here you see then one model, and this is a model where you have here the full atomic description, and here you see now the simplification, the side groups are represented, the backbone is represented by two beads per amino acid, and the side groups are represented by one or two beads depending on how large the amino acid is. And so this is a simplification, and so you pay a price, but many things can be described well with it. And here you see an example. You see how you are forming a lipoprotein particle, and this one was done many years ago, and you see this is how the particle looks like that you form. Now, how should you believe it or not? That you need a test, and here the test is now through small angle X-ray scattering, where you're getting where you take this cross grain model. You can actually reverse cross grain, so when you have a model, you can pretty easily today with our programs get a full model. It's representative of the cross grain, and now you can calculate for here the small angle X-ray scattering signal. You can also go to the argon accelerator and measure it. And here you see experiment and simulations, and they agree quite nicely. So if you know this data, what they mean, then you realize that you got the shape of these particles pretty well described. So the overall shape, that they are discs of a certain radius, is captured here well. It wasn't put in the simulation, and so it looks like reasonable. You can also do a more coarser description. For example, in case of a virus capsid, here you see we are describing one of the capsid proteins. So this one is made of 240 capsid proteins through a set of beads. So we do it several times, and it has to be a very intelligent thing. You don't put the beads by density, because then you wouldn't get this loop well. The loop is one-dimensional, the body here is three-dimensional, so you need fewer beads represented than for the tails. And so we developed an algorithm, and many other people also developed, you know, similar algorithm for putting the beads and then determining the potential that governs their motion. And then again, you have to do an experiment. And so here you see that this description worked quite well. We do the experiment where we indentate the bead, either just in a linear regime, just very little, and then the bead is reforming, or we are making a very strong indentation, and then we deform actually the capsid. And now you see here that the indentation and the force needed to indentate agrees very nicely between experiment and simulation. And so so then you can say all the coarse grain capture things. But very often people say, oh, professor, my problem takes, you know, 1 millisecond, and I cannot simulate it. Maybe I coarse grain it. And then I say, are you crazy? Don't do that. And why do I say that? I say that very simply. Coarse graining is simplification. And you can only simplify what you understand. You cannot simplify what you don't understand, you know, it's totally crazy. And so you need to understand your problem. If you have reason to believe you can then coarse grain, by all means coarse grain. But it's not like, oh, this takes too long, so I coarse grain. My friend down the hallway also coarse grained, so I do the same trick. It's logically total rubbish. A simple rule is you cannot simplify what you don't understand. And so first you need to simplify, and first you need to understand it. And you might be a give and take, you might sort of understand, say, oh, this aspect I might be able to do through cross-graining. You talk to a cross-grainer, say, oh, this is the feature that I need to reproduce. Do you think cross-graining does it? And they say, oh, yes, I think, yes. You can slowly move into there, but don't use too much haste. So then you can put things together. This is sort of what EMAT will be explaining to you. This is a potassium channel that conducts potassium ions, shown here in yellow. It's a membrane protein. So you get the PDB file, the PSF file. In this case, it's just a standard protein. So you don't have to generate the PSF file at all. You don't have to go through that big wall there, but rather you can go straight into simulation land. And you have to then fill the protein that you see here from the top with lipids. You see they're very irregular, so it's a little difficult to accommodate them. If you do that, you leave many spaces. So you usually do it, you put the protein in the middle of an equilibrated lipid that you got from a friend. People are very generous, and if people simulated certain membranes, they usually share them with you. So you go to a friend and you said, oh, this is exactly the membrane to which I want to put my lipid membrane, that I wish would put my protein. Can you give me a equilibrated membrane? And you have to be pretty bad fellow or woman to not to say yes. And so then you take it and then you say, then you put your protein there, and then you look where the protein overlaps with the lipid atom. Whenever there's an overlap, you take the whole lipid away. But then of course you do a little overkill. You're getting a lot of empty space that you see here, and now you must put it together again, and that is sort of like a little bit of an art. You can do it through constant pressure simulations, and you can also do it through other tricks and methods that EMAT will be telling you. Then you have your system. And so you see now the lipid is very nicely adjacent to the protein. And so everything looks fine. And then you characterize it. You want to know how many water molecules you have, how many lipids of one type, of another type, how many atoms altogether. These are the things that you should report in your publication, which version of the charm force field you used. Did you use periodic boundary conditions? Did you do long-range electrostatics? Periodic boundary conditions you use in order to prevent surface effects. If you just have one piece and you have a surface that behaves very strangely, if you have periodic, then you have many, many copies of your system, but you don't have a surface problem. And that you have many copies is much less severe than that you have a surface that is artificial, because your experiments are not done on very, very small volumes of probes. And so then you have to equilibrate your system at least for a nanosecond. I think the old slide today would more like do 10 nanoseconds. And then you do the dynamics, yeah, 2 nanosecond dynamics. Okay, oh, this was a tutorial problem. So the times are very short. So today I tell you, like, you can do 10 nanosecond dynamics, but you might want to do a little longer. If you have the slightest doubt, you have to do a little longer. Okay, so this is how you do it. And then you're getting results, and the results characterize a protein. One of the things you look at is how the protein deviates from its initial state, and you calculate what you call the root mean square deviation of the atoms, and then you see that the atoms move away, but then they stay constant. And so here you're making a big error, and then it says constant. No, you don't make an error. This is physics. There's thermal motion. You start with a particular geometry, but the thing is moving. That atom is not standing still there. It's vibrating, vibrating. All of them are vibrating. That gives rise to exactly a Rubin square deviation of sort of effectively 1.5 angstrom. That is the smallest RMSD value you can actually expect from thermal motion. And everything bigger is just on top of thermal motion. You wouldn't call it an error. Once you get below 3.5, then it becomes dangerous. Very important is that the root mean square deviation doesn't change in time, that it is constant. If it would go linear like this, then every good advisor would tell you, sorry, that you, that the simulation is not stable, the system is drifting away, and you cannot do this. Now you can also look at the fluctuation or the root mean square deviation per residue. Here you see the residue number, and you see that then you find sometimes very high flexibility and sometimes you find very low. Did you make a mistake here? No, these are usually the loops of the protein. At the ends you also find often flexibilities. So it's very natural that you have secondary structure where you have much less flexibility, and then you have loops where you have more flexibility, secondary structure, loop, and so on.
Mm-hmm. What is the selectivity filter?
Excuse me?
What is the selectivity filter on the upper?
The selectivity filter is here. And this is made of two alpha helices that are, however, inverted. So in the old days when I was a kid, the telephone still had these helical telephone cables, and then what, you know, you play with it and your parents complain at you and you play anyway, and you realize when you take a cable, you can unwind the helical pattern, and when you continue rotating, you are getting now an inverted helical pattern. And so that takes a lot of energy for a kid and for the protein. So the proteins do that not very often, because you have here a part of the structure that is energetically very costly. But what happens is that the alpha helix is stabilizing itself by putting the backbone atoms inward and making hydrogen bonds between the backbone atoms. And that way you have then hydrogen bonds that stabilize the helix. When you are over-twisting the helix, then you are sending now the backbone atoms to the outside. Here, these ones are all CO atoms here. And so now you are not interacting with the ion with those floppy side groups, but rather with this very short, very structurally well-defined backbone atoms. And you find this actually, I won't say very common, but several channels have exactly this kind of construction, like aquaporin has exactly the same kind of construction to guide the water and to be sure that it's very selective for water and glycerin actually, linear alcohols, but it doesn't conduct other stuff. Yes, this is the selectivity filter. That is where the system, it becomes selective only for potassium over sodium.
Well, that second picture, using a PMD, could I overlap the sequence structure we saw yesterday over the beta factor?
These are not yet beta factors. Oh, yeah, they are related to beta factors, but these are just here mean square fluctuations of the side groups as a whole,
okay,
rather
so can
than.
Can I overlay the two together from VMD, or do I have to do it manually?
No, you can do that. You can do it with VMD. It helps you there. This one is from, I assume these are different runs. So I don't know what the difference is here. Here we see that we only did the root mean square deviation of the selectivity filter, then of the whole protein. This might be the same, that you just, this is whole protein. So this could be different runs at different temperature or under different conditions. Sorry, I forgot now what it is. But this one is really a wonderful source of comparison to crystallographic data, particularly to NMR data. And you're getting usually the easiest thing to get, and the first thing to then compare, to get computationally, and then the first thing we can compare to experiment to get the feeling that you're looking right. So if you have a water soluble protein, you have an NMR, they publish these kind of fluctuations, and then you compare and say, oh, look, so I got it exactly like the NMR experiment. So that gives you already the first confidence in your work.
The other four monomers.
Okay, four monomers. So this is so this one has four monomers. This monomer one, monomer two, and now we have one monomer three, and the fourth one monomer four. Okay, thank you. So then you can describe now the whole process of ion conduction. You see that the intermediate, they were postulated by MacKinnon in his Nobel Prize lecture and in his papers, of course. And you see that this conduction is really like a knock-on mechanism. One ion knocks on, and then and this ion leaves out, and a new ion goes in. And so you can understand what you get. And this is then the sort of like another of the things you will of course do to gain confidence that your simulation gives you the right results. The time?
How much simulation time was needed to see the...
Oh, this was, at the time was pretty long, like, not that long, I forgot, maybe 100 nanoseconds. But it was not a very big simulation. It was more, actually, we published it, but it was more like, actually, I'm pretty sure this was done, actually, for this course. And then it looked so cute that we said, okay, we wrote a letter to Biophysics Journal on it. But we didn't feel like we enriched science very much with this simulation. It just worked out so nicely that we did it, and so that tells me that it was easy. So this is, I think today you can do it in one afternoon.
Does it need a
potential as a membrane? Yes. So here we. To get the ion through, you can do it two ways. You can place an ion here, then you have a concentration gradient, and that ion will then finally get there and kick them, and then one leaves there. Or you can put it with a potential, and I think I showed before for a potassium channel, including the voltage gates. And that was a simulation of 350 simulations. And that took actually two and a half years to do. Everything needed to be checked well, because we wanted to understand how the voltage gates can sense the voltage difference, which is just a very few kT, and then lead to closing and opening. And the answer was actually that the potential is actually the potential gradient that you get when you put in, let's say, 100 millivolt voltage on a membrane is actually developing only right inside the channel. So the potential goes constant. So here's positive, there's negative. So there we go to the floor, and here we come here, and it goes basically constant, because water is such a high dielectric constant. Every physics student can tell you, if you have high dielectric medium, low dielectric medium, high dielectric medium, a potential goes linear here, very, very small slope, linear here, when you have homogeneous low dielectric, and then linear the rest. And now this, here we have sort of like a very intelligent heterogeneous dielectric system. And here we are getting then the gradient falling off really literally within about 10 angstrom of the voltage gates. The potential goes down, and now when you play around with it, then it makes actually a reasonable effect on the side groups, and then it works. So there is actually a very nice trick. The alpha helices have a repeat of four in most proteins. But in the voltage gates, you have four arginines, and three of them are 1, four, seven. So there are one, they have a repeat by three, and then the next one is one skipped, and then comes the next one six steps later. And so if you have a helix, the arginine would go slowly around like this. But now you have the possibility of having a three helix. You call it the 3-10 helix, where you have a repeat of three. And so now the helix realizes, and when the potential is there, that it's better for the arginine to form a straight line. And so then the helix twists itself into from a four helix into a three helix for four turns. And that way you're getting a rotation, and that rotation pulls on the central, so this one is about the same in a voltage-gated potassium channel, but it's surrounded then by four voltage gates, and that generates a pull on these channels here, on these alpha helices there, and then it opens a channel here. You also have a little gating here, but the gating is actually here, and you just basically pull it, and basically it, roughly speaking, it's like I rotate myself and pull. And then when I rotate back, and I rotate like this, so you have this transition from a four to three helix. So, So I think, we have maybe maybe I do one more thing, and then we have a few questions, and then we maybe have a mini break, or Emad will start. So now we are doing a little experiment, and now I did all the talking, and now you have to also contribute. And so what we have now here is the following. We do some calculation, and we have a protein, and our protein has all these interaction energies, and the energies that we have is first the kinetic energy, and then we have the energy from the harmonic bond vibe, from the harmonic bonds, the harmonic energy from the angles, and then we have here the dihedral energy. This sums over all the dihedral energy contribution. This sums over all the quadratic bond stretch energies. This sums over all the quadratic angles. And here we have the van der Waals energy. And here we have the total Coulomb energy. So we can calculate this one separately, this one separately, this one separately, this one separately, and this one separately, and the kinetic energy separately. And we did this as an experiment in quite a few workshops, and everybody had to do and calculate these energies for different temperatures. So you had to do 50, 75, 100, and so on. And then we plotted the energies. So here's temperature, and here are then the values. And now I want to know from you how the results looked like. So let's go to this one here, the kinetic energy. What do you think how the kinetic energy looks like if we calculate the kinetic energy at different temperatures?
Increasing.
What?
Increasing with temperature?
Yeah, but a little bit more. We are talking quantitative biology. But you're right, increasing is good, but can you tell me a little bit more how it increases with temperature? But it's already good, because you'll see that it was good, better maybe than you think at the moment when you compare with other ones. Why linear?
KT.
Exactly. Every degree of freedom kinetic energy is KT. So if we are adding it all up, then we are getting, for each degree of freedom, we have n atoms. Each atom has three contributions, x, y, z, 3/2 nkBT is the energy. So this should go linear in energy. How about these guys? This one and this one. We have physicists here. Who wants to admit that he's a physicist and should be ashamed now? Nobody wants to admit that he wants to be ashamed now. Otherwise, in the party, when you meet the girls at the party, you say, oh, I'm a theoretical physicist. I'm really smart. But now you don't want to admit it. Okay. These are quadratic. And there's a famous statistical mechanics theorem that they call the equipartition theorem that tells you that every quadratic degree of freedom goes linear in temperature. This is quadratic in the velocity, so it goes also linear. And this one is quadratic in position, so it goes also linear. These ones, there's no theorem. They go all over the place. And not too bad, actually, but here's what you get. Linear, and then this one here sort of looks linear, but it's almost constant. And here you see, it's sort of, this is a total. This one here, the Coulomb energy goes up and down, but it's also more constant. But here you go linear, and when you look at the slope, from the slope you can calculate how many atoms you have. So if you go the slope, you would be able to calculate n. And here you can calculate from this slope you can calculate how many bonds you have, because each bond contributes an harmonic energy. And here you can also calculate from this one how many angles you have. And the PSF file actually tells you the total number. Namely tells you the total number then, because it's written in the PSF file. And so usually this number you can check immediately in the NEMBI output, and they can check if you got it right. So this works really well. That means your simulation, even though it didn't know anything about thermodynamics, reproduces the thermodynamic laws. Okay, so then when you go to look at the velocities of atoms, here are the x, y, and z velocities of one atom we picked out. You see they got these green and blue, all average around zero. And then you plot them in a histogram, the velocities, then they follow a Gaussian. So here we didn't do much analysis because we wanted to actually have an error. If you do long enough, you're getting a beautiful Gaussian. And you're seeing that also the Maxwell distribution is beautifully reproduced in your simulation. That means that your atom in your computer is really working very nicely according to the laws of statistical mechanics. Now, when you then look at the total kinetic energy here, then you can use this is total kinetic energy, you can use this rule to calculate the temperature. So here we plot the total kinetic energy, here we plot the corresponding energy. They fluctuate around. Where do these fluctuations come from? Any guess? Numerical error? No, there's of course a numerical error involved there, that is also statistic, stochastic. But this is actually the fact that you don't get a sharp temperature is that you have a finite system. A protein has, 2,000 atoms or something. And because it's finite, the temperature, here you see it is Gaussian distributed. These are just the data taken there. But when you do a little calculation, so you get it in the PDF file I sent to you, so I don't want to belabor the calculation. You can derive it, and then you find this is a distribution of the temperature at a certain given temperature. It is the width here, sigma squared, is 2 temperature squared divided by 3n, where n is the number of atoms of your protein, when you just sample here over the protein. And so you're getting a width of the thermodynamic quantity. So this is how these macromolecules that we simulate behave. They behave very close to thermodynamics, basically thermodynamics. You see that the width of the temperature, this is 300 Kelvin, this is 295 and 307. So you see the width is pretty narrow. And so you can say, they all have a constant temperature. You say not quite right, a little distributed, but otherwise they follow the thermodynamics. And so it's one of the things you can also use for testing. If you do a simulation, am I sure that I don't do something really crazy? And you can test it like the thermodynamic properties and even the distributions. Okay, so with this one, I want to end now, and I wanted to give you some examples in modern research, but I think would be just some pretty pictures and stuff. You probably believe that we can do great science with it. Here we really want to be sure that we are telling you the basics and not beating our chest in front of you. So, okay, good. So, I want to end here now with taking questions.
Mm-hmm. And the selectivity filter.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why do we want to look at the selectivity filter, which is the region of the protein separately from the
yeah,
protein?
So in
how
this case,
if the whole structure goes to kind of Batten disease level in all leveling, is it possible that this region, particular region from it, would not?
So, you know, here one had the intuitive feeling that the selectivity filter might be more rigid than the rest of the protein. And so we plotted it and could plot the rest of the protein. We saw, oh, they are both equally rigid. So it's not like that part of the protein is really very, very firm and the rest of it is very floppy. So it's sort of interesting that the selectivity filter, the protein has a pretty low would mean square deviation, 1.5 is a very rigid protein, but the protein as a whole is rigid, not just the selectivity filter, that's what that tells you. But in some other cases, you find that some parts of the protein are quite flexible and others are more rigid. You find actually sometimes quite big differences. For example, something one does routinely is not so much in a functional direction, but what one often does routinely is one calculates the root mean square deviation only for the backbone atoms, and then for the whole protein. And then one might find, for example, that the backbone is 2.5 angstrom and the whole protein is 3.5 angstrom. Probably people who do that go as follows. They say, oh, let's calculate the root mean square of our protein. 3.5 angstrom, the student tells the professor. The professor says, oh, it's a little high. Ooh. Why don't you calculate the backbone? And they hope then, or she hopes then, that the student comes back with a lower value for the backbone, and then when the student comes next day, oh, backbone is 2.5, then it's okay, we can publish it. We can say, look, backbone is very stable, the rest of the protein is flexible, and so people will take it.
So it's a measure of the rigidity of the...
Yeah, but for example, you might see that, you might expect from your protein or your macromolecule that it has a certain flexibility in a certain part because of its function. Let's say a channel has to admit a substrate and there might be a loop and the loop has to fluctuate enough. Then you might see that in the root mean square deviation. Say, oh, here we have a flexible part and that makes good sense. And here we have, for example, the active site of an enzyme is very rigid. And that makes also good sense. So you might have active site, 1.5 angstrom, protein 2.5, and an exit or entrance channel 3.5, and you would say, oh, that looks very reasonable. I captured some of the, you know, typical properties expected for this kind of protein.
Would the effect of restraining an entire region of protein be similar to that cross-graining that region?
No. When you restrain, you just don't let the atoms move. Cross-graining is replacing the changing the dynamics. Basically, says I'm not. Let's say if I go to an analogy from society, then you would say I want to know I want to know the food intake in a city for every person. And I do statistics for every person. And now you're doing a new statistics only for families. So then you say families is my coarse graining. Family is for me a unit. And so now this would be statistics. Now you could also say I want to see the mobility of individuals in the community or families in the community. And then you would say, oh, I can describe the community very well by thinking of the family as one unit. Modern family like mine, I'm here, my wife is at home, wouldn't probably work well, but in maybe some older communities, the family was a good building block for cross-graining. But you basically have a new dynamics. The dynamics of the atoms is being replaced by the atoms of beads, by the dynamics of beads that represent the dynamics of the entire system. So you nod, but you don't look convinced.
No, because I'm thinking of my next question.
Okay. Maybe I ask that lady, and okay.
If you run MDS of a wild type system, and you have suspicion that there's some allosteric mutation in your system, can you then take the mutation, if you have two or three, and run that in coarse grain?
Yeah, here we have a situation where the coarse grain may be right away at its limit, because when you do the coarse graining, the only way you might account for the fact that you have now another amino acid is that you are changing the mass of the bead by one or two or three atomic units, because when you do the mutation, you might have a little heavier side group. Otherwise, the bead looks exactly the same. Then you would say, oh, this coarse grain model that my friend gave me is not really good for doing mutational studies. I have to do an all-atom simulation where I really replace one amino acid by another amino acid, let's say an alanine by an aspartate or something. So alanine aspartate, the coarse graining, most coarse graining would do that right, because you also have a different charge. And they deal with an aspartate differently from an alanine, so I don't want to be too unfair. But when you come to some detail like mutational effects, then you better don't cross grain. Mm-hmm. So.
So I had a couple of questions. I'm wondering, for the electrostatics, do any of the force fields take into account ionic conditions in a buffer sort of situation, and device screening lengths, and how salty buffers would affect charge screening?
So you need to take into account ionic effects by putting the ions there. So in every reasonable every sensible simulation should have ions at the appropriate ionic strengths. Now you have to realize, however, that in many cellular processes, the ionic strengths, the overall ionic strengths, might not be the local ionic strengths. So you would think about, if you get really crazy results, you may think, or maybe we have really a different ion concentration where the process takes place for good reasons than in the average over the cell. So you have to maybe a different one. For a channel, that could be very important. So that's number one. Number two is dielectric screening is a result of the simulation. If you put ions, then they screen effectively just the way you read it in the textbook on dielectric screening. The textbook says the ions move around, and thereby they screen the effect of two charges relative to one another. This moving around is what you simulate. So it has to be the result of the simulation. You cannot then say, oh, with this much ionic strength, I have a different dielectric constant, so I change the dielectric constant. That would be an absolute error. You double dip basically the physics. So that is number two. Ooh, there was some, and then a very important effect is a pH. So the pH affects the protonation state of side groups, and so that you need to consider very carefully. First, you have to really conscientious about every protonation state of amino acid in your group, in your system, or even if it's big, you know, you cannot take it easily. And so that you have to do one. And now, however, the field goes quite quickly to a situation where we do what we call constant pH calculations, where you give the pH and then the program calculates a longer trajectory at certain points, what is the likely protonation state of all the side groups. And then it reassigns them at certain times. Not every integration step would be too costly. And so it suggests a protonation state, and it also updates it should the protein change its conformation and thereby change its local pKa values. So that is, but if you don't have a constant pH calculation, you have to really think yourself very carefully about the protonation state. And many, many errors have been made that way.
And those pKa values are calculated on the fly?
They would be calculated, the protonation state is calculated on the fly. The pKa, of course, is sort of a property of the protein. You can say that because it could change. So they can account for the protonation state. And the protonation state, of course, the titration describes the titration behavior of a certain site group. And if that changes due to changes in conformation, then it changes. And then you could say they also calculate the pKa value. But what they really calculate is the protonation state. Mm-hmm. So there was a question there at the very end.
So
and then comes. No, absolutely not. We are not there yet. It's only done at the moment, as far as I know, in CHARM, and we try to put it. So I would say it's at least 2 years off. Yeah, so it's not automatic. So you had a question? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And you set all of the histidines in the beginning to unprotonated, just neutral in the beginning.
Yeah, but that's not what you. Well, that's exactly what I told you. Don't use all the word. Oh, I put all the histidines neutral. No, you have to think about every histidine.
Right.
If you have a reason that you know they're all neutral one by one by one, you'll put them all neutral. But don't go like, oh, we put all histidines neutral as if it's a birthright. So you have to think about every protonation state very carefully, and there could be a histidine that's very important where you just chose the wrong protonation state, also where you put the hydrogen bonds, and so that could be, you know, making your result poor. So you have to be very conscientious.
So you would not recommend just setting all to neutral in the beginning?
Maybe I would say to the student, okay, why don't you put it? But you know, I would tell him three stories in my life where I made the big mistake with the protonation state. But you know, you have to get going, so why don't you just get going now? But it should be really in the back of their mind, they have to be very careful.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to be sure, but you can go. Mm-hmm. Okay, so please. Low what?
Low temperature.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because, for example, for small system, water, the phase transition for water with ice is not mm-hmm. really zero. It depends on the mm-hmm. surface to volume ratio of your mm-hmm. system. In this case, we have small boxes. So how you define low temperature is still liquid or not? So what are the problems with dealing with low temperature simulation?
Okay, so there are sort of two answers. First, you know, like I'm in the physics department, and my my physics colleagues habitually pour liquid nitrogen or helium over everything to make the experiments easier. And we, of course, deal with 300 Kelvin. So, you know, that is, we need to understand 300 Kelvin. But it is totally fine to go to low temperature, just say, look, this is, you know, we should also do computational experiments. And we go to low temperature to see how does the behavior of the system change. But our emphasis should be to learn then about the biological situation. It's totally fine to go to some odd conditions like very low temperature. Okay, but now how can we find out? This is actually not easy, what is liquid and what is ordered, but there is a way of doing it, and that is by calculating the pair correlation function of the material, let's say of water or some ions that can be either fluid or form an aggregate. And so it's very costly, but we can do that in NMD today or in VMD actually after simulation with GPUs, so we can calculate for rather large systems. Then you can recognize from the pattern of the correlation function if you have a solid. If it's a liquid, you have usually one peak for the next neighbor and almost no peak anymore for the further neighbors. Whereas if it's a solid, you're getting several rings because you're getting long range order, and that is indicative that you have a solid system. It came, but on the scale of the simulation, the distance relationship of one atom is not only reaching to the neighbor to keep that atom at bay, but they also control the next, the over next, and the third one even, because you're getting features, and so that can also be in the glassy system. The glassy system is now different, that over time this is moving, whereas in the solid it's not moving. But anyway, with a pair correlation function, you can see if you have a more solid type of object, so that you don't have fluidity or not.
Mm-hmm. Can you use a mean free pass to distinguish liquid and solid?
What did that?
Mean free pass.
Mean?
Atom moves.
The mean free pass. Yeah, but that is that's usually not useful because. Diffusion processes are usually very slow, so when you look at the mean square deviation, like you get from diffusive behavior, you find you're getting it for a short time and then stops, because the system cannot. It immediately goes. It's like a big party, you know. You go to a party, very many people there. When you start, you're getting almost stuck. Like the first 10 minutes, you stay at one place. You don't even get your drink. But then over the course of the whole evening, you have almost said hello to everybody, and you got your drink and so on. And so so here, when you take your mean path of view, you would see only local. And then once in a while, suddenly one fellow moves away, and then you can go to the next place, and then to the next place. And so, and this is usually hard to capture because people have to move out of the way. For example, the lipid diffusion takes very long simulations. And so so you don't usually see really that kind of typical path you would expect, because diffusion is a pretty slow process. Mm-hmm. Okay. That is a period of a CH vibration. It's of course mainly the hydrogen atom in this case.
It's one of the fastest vibrations.
That is the fastest.
And so in the tutorial it said that if we use a time step of 2 femtoseconds, mm-hmm. you should keep the hydrogen bonds fixed.
That's right.
If we use 1 femtosecond, do we also have?
No. Then you can rotate. Then you can let it vibrate. For 2 femtoseconds, you can also let it vibrate, but you basically, a period of 5 femtoseconds, a vibration is then being described as jumps, as 4 jumps, 5 jumps, and that is not a very smooth motion. And so 10 is sort of okay, but 5 is not so good, and so then you keep them fixed. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I would suggest then that we just have, Imad is just not here, I would say we have now our break and then we continue. And I would say, let's say 10 minutes. Okay.